What's a quasi-perfect number? Well, a perfect number is a number that's equal to the sum of its proper divisors, like 6. Its divisors are 1, 2, 3, and 6, but that's not a proper divisor. 1 plus 2 plus 3 equals 6. So 6 is a perfect number. A quasi-perfect number, well, that's a number where the sum of the proper divisors is 1 more than the number itself. That's a quasi-perfect number. Only thing is, nobody's ever found any. But it's still an open question as to whether or not there are any. And so as a high school student, I actually worked on that problem and proved that if there were any quasi-perfect numbers lurking out there, they had to at least satisfy certain properties.
Of all the things, like there's all these glamorous things like prime numbers and proper perfect numbers, why did you pick this obscure little one that has this?
Well, I was a student at a National Science Foundation summer program in mathematics that was held at Hampshire College in Massachusetts. And it was a wonderful 6-week program and learned lots of math. And amongst other things, one afternoon I went to the Hampshire College Library, which didn't have that all many books on mathematics, but did have some book on number theory. And I pulled out this book and I found that I even remember there was a description of quasi-perfect numbers and some result that had been proved about them by someone called Sierpinski. And we'd been talking about perfect numbers and other things, and I was struck by that result, and I wondered, could I do any better? And it turned out I could do somewhat better. And I ended up writing a Westinghouse Prize contest paper about that. The Westinghouse is now the Intel Prize, and it ended up winning the thing. But mostly, what was cool to me was I could see something in a textbook and find that I could extend, even by a little bit, about what's kind of a relatively unimportant subject, all of human knowledge by some tiny little bit. And once you learn that, that's kind of addictive. Oh, I confess, I don't even remember all the details about what it was. It's now been, more than 35 years since I proved that. But it was a set of constraints on what the structure of the number was. I think it had to be one more than a square and some other things and how many prime factors. And the truth is, I haven't followed quasi-perfect numbers since then. It's probably not a really, really important question per se, although the question about the distribution of divisors and their sums, that's a good and important question in number theory. But it was more that it was a totally understandable, tractable question that a high school student could understand. It wasn't hard to pose the definition of it. And to realize that you could pose a definition in a sentence and that all the mathematicians in the world still didn't know if there were any meant that there were just an infinite number of really cool mysteries out there. They were accessible in some way. So, you know, I loved mathematics for that. As a high school student, I loved mathematics. I did my undergraduate degree in pure mathematics at Princeton and my PhD in pure mathematics at Oxford. And, you know, just loved it. I think so many people love mathematics because within your mind, there is a world that you can create and experiment in and find the regularities in and the laws of without needing a laboratory. It's all accessible.
It doesn't seem the default position for a high school student to read about that and then think, let's nut out a proof. They're more likely to read that and think, oh, I wonder if I can find one and just start taking stabs in the dark. But you went and made like a proper structured mathematical proof.
Well, you know, I think the cool thing, this particular National Science Foundation program that I went to as a high school student had as its motto, find patterns, make conjectures, prove things. I think that sums up what mathematics is about. And we gave emphasis to all of those. So I went there as a student, then I went back and taught for 3 summers as a faculty member at it while I was in college teaching high school students about it. And I think all 3 have an equally important role in mathematics, finding pattern. People, non-mathematicians get the sense that mathematics is this really dry and boring thing. Somebody gives you a problem and asks you to prove it or calculate a number or something. Of course, what mathematicians really do is they look for the regularities in the world, and the discoveries that get made are the most interesting part of mathematics. Then when you see a pattern, you don't quite know how to describe it and phrase it. And the act of phrasing a conjecture, I believe that this pattern I'm seeing means that there's an infinite number of twin primes, for example, or that there are no solutions, that all the solutions to a certain type of equation, which primes can be written as the sum of two squares, have a certain form. Learning how to take a pattern and turn it into a rigorous conjecture, that's also an important work of mathematicians. And then finally, when you have a rigorous conjecture, figuring out how you could possibly prove it. And so I think we learned most of all that that was what mathematics was about. And therefore, when you saw something and there was a conjecture about it, you wanted to think about how you might prove that. So yeah, it was actually perfectly natural for, you know, math kids. I was a math kid in New York City. I was a lower middle class kid from Brooklyn. I had the opportunity to go to Stuyvesant High School in Manhattan, one of New York City's absolutely free public but exam schools for math and science. And I loved it. I got to Stuyvesant High School in ninth grade, discovered there was this math team, people meeting at 8 o'clock in the morning at Stuyvesant High School, coming in an hour before classes to get together to do problems. And so the math team quickly became a home for me. I came in an hour early, went to the math team every day for the course of 4 years, eventually became the captain of that math team. And in those ancient days before computers and the internet and everything, there was a special trove of problems that we had to work on, and they were all stored in the shopping bag. The Stuyvesant High School math team had the shopping bag filled with problems, and it was in the care of the captain of the math team that the shopping bag was kept.
Because you won this really prestigious prize because of these numbers, I'm imagining you feel some kind of, do you still find any kind of attachment to it? And like, would you love to find out if there is one, or have you just moved on now? And it's like,
well, I mean, it would be cool to find out, but I've moved on since. There are other things I'm fascinated by. I think what was wonderful about the summer high school program, was wonderful about the Westinghouse contest, what was wonderful about the Stuyvesant High School math team, was much more the community of people who cared. What it really meant to me was there was a life in this. You could actually make a living. You could actually have a community. You could actually have friends and colleagues who cared about deeply intellectual problems. And you know, growing up where I did in the outskirts of Brooklyn, not everybody was like that. And so for a student to discover that there's a world of people who care about such things and live for such things, whether it's mathematics or biology, or mathematics and biology, things I do today, that was the real eye-opening thing. And if quasi-perfect numbers was a way to get there, that was great. But I don't necessarily have an attachment to them, but they were a wonderful guide along the trail.
You don't feel like you owe them one?
No, I think we're square.
Do you think there's one out there? What's your gut tell you?
Oh, goodness. Well, it's really tough. I don't have a good gut feeling on it. I mean, I'd like to say there aren't any, because none have been found. But I don't think there's a tremendously good reason to believe there aren't any. The iPhone, which is gorgeous, and I love my iPhone, seems so important and directly valuable. But all the fundamental physics and the electronics and the computer science that makes an iPhone possible, they're crucial to the existence of an iPhone. And Steve Jobs would have said that, and Tim Cook at Apple will say that the beautiful things you encounter in your daily life, whether it's an iPhone or a drug that'll cure a disease,